generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the land. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, oh, creation cries, holy, you were lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, if you've been redeemed, if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the land. Oh, we'll sing the song forever and amen, and the angels cry, holy, our creation's cry, holy, you are lifted high. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, oh,
How's everybody? Everybody good? Okay, we'll take good. We'll take good. Thank you for asking. I'm wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome to Wednesday night prayer and Bible study. So before we begin, man, there's certainly just a lot going on. Anybody got any prayer reports or prayer requests they'd like to share? Just realized it happened. You got me. That's good. That's good. Thank you. So I'd like for the church to keep up. A gentleman I used to work with, his name is Cedric Bryant, and I just found out today that he lost his father and his sister in an automobile accident. And I think the sister died maybe one day last week, and the father passed away this week. So, yes. So his name is Cedric Bryant. Anybody got anything else they'd like to share?
Remember, on Sunday we're supposed to offer a continual sacrifice of praise. Right?
I remember that.
So there's got to be something.
Yes, sir.
There's got to be something.
Yes, sir.
We're here.
Yeah. Amen to that.
Amen.
Amen to that.
And he is with us.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
I thank God for the opportunity to share with us. Every Wednesday we have Bible study in our community. And I thank God for that opportunity.
Yes, sir.
Dave came to Christ through that. His wife came to Christ. Miss Melissa.
Yes.
So I thank God for that.
Bless his name, Stan. Bless his name. And we want to remember the Sanya family in our prayers tonight. Got some health challenges going on, so I want to keep them lifted up.
What?
Sanya. It's my wife's people's.
I just got a text message from Lord Blake, and she said, please ask for prayer for Tim's dad when he's in the hospital with AFib.
Okay.
Keep Pastor Frank's back in prayer if it happens. Back problems.
All right, guys.
Let's pray. God, we're thankful for today. Lord, I pray that you would help us to rejoice and to be glad in it. Thank you for the privilege to be here in your house tonight. We recognize your presence here with us. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would meet us today. Give us ears to hear and hearts to respond to your word. Pray that you would be with Joel, your messenger for tonight. Give him clarity of speech, clarity of thought. God, help us to have a thirst for your word, not just to read it, but to study it. For how else will we get to know you better and your will for our lives? God, you tell us in your word to pray for all the saints and to lift all kinds of prayer requests up to heaven. And Lord, I'd ask you that, first of all, you'd forgive us of our sins so as to hinder any of our prayers that we utter. Thank you for your sacrifice on the cross for dying in our place. Lord, we do lift up Tim's dad. I pray that you would calm his heart. You created us. You know what a sound heart looks and sounds like. I pray that you would just give him peace, calm his spirit. I pray, just be with the doctors and the nurses just tonight. Pray to be with Tim and Lori, the grandchildren, brothers and sisters. Pray that you would grant them a peace that passes all understanding. For Pastor Frank and his back, I pray that you would give him strength to continue to work. Ask you would just alleviate the pain, heal his back, strengthen the muscles so that he can do the job that he's called to do. God, for Sandra's family and the health issues there. We read today that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. You healed in the past, and we claim healing in Sandra's family, even tonight, for healing in her family. Pray that you would act in a supernatural way, that it would be recognized that Jesus was at work. Do pray for Melissa's extended family. You know her heart, and the loss of loved ones can be very difficult. I pray that you would give comfort in a time of grieving, love like only you can. And again, I pray that you would use Melissa to show the love of Jesus to those that may not know you and her family. And we give you thanks in advance for what you're going to do for Cedric. God, I don't understand the loss of a father and a sister, but your word says that we can come boldly before the throne of grace so that you would meet us and meet our needs. So we do that tonight for this family. Again, I pray that you would provide comfort during grieving. Pray that your name would be glorified. And God, use this time to strengthen Cedric's heart and the family's heart. Nothing catches you by surprise. You're all-knowing, all-powerful. And your word tells us that we should trust in you at all times. So we do that. We ask you tonight that you would give us the strength that we need to trust you at all times, in the good times and in the bad. Thank you for loving us unconditionally. Help us to love you with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all our strength. Help us to love our neighbors as ourselves. We give you praise today because you're worthy. We thank you for your promises in your word. Pray that you pleased with all that is said and communicated tonight. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, guys. So we've been studying about how to study the Bible, and one of my goals has been to try to give you kind of a understanding of why God's Word is important, the benefits of studying His Word, and to try to give you some tools on how to study. And I want to speak tonight more on importance of why studying the Word of God is important, and just review some concepts concerning that. So I want you to just think here for a minute. If we all agree that the Bible is the most important book ever written, we can all agree to that. So it would stand to reason that it would be one of the most manipulated books of all time. And so we have to be careful when studying it that we avoid some of the pitfalls that many of us fall into because we do it casually. And we don't understand that there is a war over this word. There is a war that Satan and demonic forces don't want us to be able to grasp the word, because there is hidden treasures in it. There's things that will help us, if we implement them in our lives, live a holy and righteous life. Okay, so one of the things that the kingdom of darkness wants to do is to make these just be words on a page but not effectual in your life. And if he can get you to believe that it makes no difference whether you read it or not, then you won't read it. And if you won't read it, then you won't discover what's in it. Okay? All right. So, did you find it?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I'm not...
My
man. All right, so just hold on to it. So my first slide there. So again, we're just going to do a little background here. All right, y'all probably have to make that a little bigger. Okay. Just don't tell nobody, Anna. Y'all can read it, though. I'll make it bigger next time. Thank you, though. Okay. So let's just go back just a little bit. And I want you to imagine, and y'all work with me now because I'm just using an example, that you heard that your great-grandma was a wonderful person, very loving, very kind, never met a stranger type person, very, very giving. And one day you come upon some letters that she had written, but she wrote in a different language. She wasn't English, she was German. You don't speak German, so these letters are in German. So someone then comes up to you and they tell you what the letters say. And they say things that are contrary to what you've known about your grandmother, your great-grandmother, okay? So I said all that to say, when we are reading this Bible, right, we have to understand who the author is, and the author is not man, the author is God. So when we begin to interpret the Bible, when we begin to read the Bible, we have to do it in the context, the overall context of who we know God is, loving, all-powerful, all-knowing, plan of redemption for man. So we know all these things about God, okay? So when we're reading any text from the Bible, we want to make sure that we're aware of these five things. Who is the author? Who is speaking to us? Who wrote that particular passage? Okay. Who is the audience of that person? Okay. What is the subject and the circumstances surrounding the topic? When is all this taking place? Where is the setting? And why was it written? So let's just go with an example. The book of Genesis. So who wrote the book of Genesis? Moses. Who was Moses' audience? The Israelites, right? Say yes.
Yes.
Okay. So it was the Israelites. So that was his primary audience, was the Israelites. So when we read passages of Scripture, we always have to keep these things in mind. Okay, one of the things we want to also note about the Bible is that your Bible is not in chronological order, right? So the book of Job is not chronologically behind Genesis, but it actually took place either sometime during Genesis. Okay, and there are some Bibles that are called chronological Bibles, and their books are laid out in chronological order, okay? So when Moses, he said, for this reason that a man should leave his mother and his father and cleave unto his wife, right? So what father and mother did Adam and Eve leave? None, right? But he put that in a context so that people in Israel could understand how important it was. God shared this with Moses so Moses could convey to the people of Israel how important it was for a man and a woman to be married and the importance of it, okay? So these are some of the things that we need to keep in mind when we're reading text, okay? All right. Next one. So tonight, and again, my goal in this study is not to go into a detailed exposition of Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. I just want to kind of give you like a foundation that you can use to expand your study. And remember, in all of our study, we always want to seek the guidance of the Holy Spirit to reveal things to us. All right, my next slide. So we're going to just talk about a concept called hermeneutics, okay? What is hermeneutics?
It says
the yeah, it's I'm going to have to hide my stuff while I talk to y'all. Yeah. So hermeneutics is basically how is the art and science of interpretation, okay? It is... So when you interpret the Bible, there's an art to it and there's a science to it. It is a science because there are principles, methods, and rules that govern how Scripture is to be interpreted. Okay? It is art because it does require some wisdom, it does require some discernment, it does require some instruction, it does require some skill, it does require some practice. And you got to put the theory into practice, okay? So I just want to give you guys just a short clip of the importance of something being interpreted. Are you ready? We didn't practice this.
Mr. Sanford, as far as you can ascertain, did you suffer any bodily injuries such as fractures, contusions, or concussions?
did you get done in?
No, I didn't get done in. I feel all right. I just got shook up a little bit.
You had to take the truck, didn't you? Who told you to take
it? Be cool. We can't lose our heads now. We just act like we're playing checkers. Now relax. It's your move. Come on in. The door's open.
Out of my Fred.
Hi. Oh,
hey, what's the problem? We just sit down here playing some checkers.
Yeah. Hey, Bill Smitty.
I'd like you to meet my new driving partner. This is Officer Swanhauser. We do the rounds together.
Hey, how you doing, Officer Swanhauser?
How you feel, Smiley?
The reason Officer Smith and myself are paying this call is for the purpose of issuing a warning.
A warrant?
A warning. It's come to the attention of the department that an as yet unidentified suspect is operating in this area and attempting to sell copper that has previously been burglarized, and that said burglary may have been perpetrated by the suspect in question.
There's a dude trying to unload some hot copper that he snatched himself.
That's good.
Bro, I thought he's dead.
So until we apprehend the suspect.
All right, so I use an example, but sometimes things need to be interpreted so that we can understand them. And guys, here's the deal. The goal of God writing these things down for us is so that we would understand it. Not just so that it was written, so that we would understand it, okay? So, next slide. So why do we need hermeneutics? Well, hermeneutics is important because all literature must be interpreted. And one of the reasons is it needs to be interpreted because for this literature, we weren't there when it was written. Okay? So, what was the Old Testament written in? Hebrew. How many of you speak Hebrew? Besides Bill, maybe. Okay, most of us do not. New Testament written in what? Greek. How many of us know any Greek? Very few of us, okay? So when we go to read this word, there has to be an interpretation. And guys, I want you to think about it. One of the things that's got our country in a mess today is because different people interpret the U.S. Constitution different ways. We can't go back and talk to any of the original framers. We have to look at different writings that they had. We had to glean from history what type of person they were and what hills they stood on, right? And I give you an example. So the Constitution talks about that we would have the freedom of religion, right? So what was originally meant by that was that the U.S. government could not establish a religion for the people. It was not that the people could not determine their own religion and implement that in government. So what some people are taking the freedom of religion and they've turned into the freedom from religion. So the Supreme Court has the Ten Commandments in it. Like it's literally on the walls. Okay? So again, when we have poor interpretations, okay, it leads to misunderstandings, it leads to confusion, and at the end of the day, it leads to a lack of implementation upon what the word is designed to do, okay? If, the next slide. So we go to, real quickly, in the book of Galatians, Paul was talking to the Judaizers, and the Judaizers were the ones who were going around saying, hey, in order for you to have salvation, you basically got to be a Jew. You got to do all the Jewish customs to receive Christ. And Paul was like, where did you get that from? That's not what's been preached to you. That's not what's been taught to you, okay? So let's look at the importance of explaining scripture. Let's go to, in the Old Testament, let's go to the book of Nehemiah. We're going to be in chapter 8, verses 7 and 8. And I just talked about having a historical context of when something is written. So the book of Nehemiah, if we dive into the history of it just a little bit, chapter 8, verses 7 and 8. Okay, so a little bit of history here. So who was Nehemiah? So Nehemiah was a cupbearer whose brethren had came and told him that the Israelites had been freed from Babylon. They had returned back to Jerusalem, but when they got there, it was in disarray because the walls were torn down. Even though they were back home, they were still getting raided. And Ezra was the priest who was with the Israelites when they came from Babylon. So these people had been in captivity how many years? 70 years, okay? So it says, and Jeshua and Benai and Sherebiah and Jamin and Akub, Shebethai, Hodijah, Messiah, Kalita, Azara, Josabad, Hanan, Peliah, and the Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. So what happened here? They had not heard or read the word of God. It had been 70 years since many of them knew anything. They had heard about it from their parents and their grandparents. But the Levites read the scriptures and caused them to understand it. It says, so they read the book. They read in the book of the law. They read in the book, in the law of God distinctly, and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. So the Levites read the word to the people, and they explained it so the people could understand what was written in God's word. Okay? Let's go to the New Testament, Luke 24. So what's the context here? So Jesus is talking, and he's talking to the Pharisees, and they're asking him question after question, and then Jesus just goes to the heart of the matter. He says in verse 27, he says, at the beginning, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Can y'all imagine that conversation? So Jesus is going and he's talking to these people about all the things in the Old Testament, all the things that they have read and they were very familiar with. They knew the law. So Jesus then expounds and starts pointing himself out in all the Old Testament scriptures. And he expounds upon it because what? They had not seen it. Okay? All right. Let's go one more. Let's go a couple more. So let's go to in the same chapter, let's go to verse 32. And guys, this is what should happen when we're reading the Bible with the right heart, the right intent. It should cause this thing to happen to us. And it says, and they said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures. So guys, these scriptures should come alive in us, and it should marinate in our spirit, and things should come alive. And it should cause us, guys, to have a burning and a yearning for God. Opening up the scriptures. Now, if you just go about reading them, that's not going to happen. But if you go about studying them and seeking God in them, and things are revealed to you, and you get an understanding, your heart is going to burn within. Okay? Let's go to Mark 12 and 24. Mark 12. So what's happening here? So there, again, the Pharisees were asking Jesus questions, not so that they could learn anything, right? What was the main purpose of their questions? To find error in him, to trip him up, to see if he would contradict himself, right? So right before this, they're asking him about divorce and if a woman if a husband dies and who's going to remarry who and how is that going to work? And then Jesus just He just speaks to it. He says, and Jesus answered and said unto them, do ye not therefore err because ye know not the scriptures, neither the power of God? You guys are reading the scripture, but you're not trying to find me, and you're not trying to find God's power. All you're trying to do is read the scripture to show how great you are, how much you know. It's not about you getting closer to God. It's about you elevating yourself, how much you know and how much everybody else does. Jesus cuts to the heart of it, okay? Let's look at one more. John 5, starting at verse 39. John 5, starting at 39. Jesus says, search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. And ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you that ye have not the love of God in you. My goodness. So here he is again being tested by the Pharisees, and he's just cutting to the quick. He's saying, you search the scriptures and you think you find eternal life, but all the scriptures are doing is when you read them properly, they're talking about me. And he says, and notice he says, but ye will not come to me that ye might have life. Why is that? Because they've exalted themselves above the knowledge of God. He says, in verse 41, he says, I receive not honor from men. What is he saying? He says, I don't do this to be a man pleaser. I'm not here to please men. I'm here to please my Father. I'm about my Father's business. You guys are trying to go in your own little circles, trying to please each other, see who knows more than the other person, and that's not going to get it. Okay? So Jesus taught the importance of hermeneutics. And so why is all this important? Guys, because without sound hermeneutics, we will misinterpret what God is saying, be prone to error, and we won't be able to apply the principles that God designed for us to live a righteous life. It'll just become another book that we read. But it won't be a continual source for us. It won't be something that sustains us and helps us navigate what God is trying to show us in our life. I want to read this quote. The next slide. It says, there is no profit to us if God has spoken and we do not know what he has said. We need to know the correct method of biblical interpretation so that we do not confuse the voice of God with the voice of man. Remember, at the very beginning, I talked about how the enemy tries to manipulate things and to get us off on different paths. So we need to always be seeking God's voice and what God said and not what man has said, okay? And again, as I said earlier, we can never minimize the importance of the Holy Spirit in our interpretation, okay? All right. So I want to continue on why hermeneutics is important. As I said, the enemy seeks to make us weak from improper understanding of God's word. How does that happen? Next slide. Because there are many immature, untrained, and others are simply careless about the interpretation of Scripture. Let's go to 2 Peter 3 and 16. It says, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things in which are some things hard to be understood, which that they are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. What is Paul saying here? That if we aren't careful, proper misunderstanding of the scriptures by those who don't know what they're talking about, those who haven't taken the time and study, will lead to their own destruction. I didn't study this before coming here, but I have heard of Jones, where the people drank the Kool-Aid or something like that. I don't know if that was even. Yeah, but yeah, Jim Jones, right? And so these people drank this poison drink, thinking that they were gonna go to heaven. That where'd you get that from, right? Like, so if we aren't careful, guys, and we allow people who don't know what they're talking about to deceive us, no matter how powerful the word is, it's only as powerful as we apply it to our life, okay? So I heard one today that there was this cult, and I don't remember the guy's name, but he would go to hotels, and when they were getting ready to leave, that they would leave and not pay their bill. And some of his followers asked him, said, "Well, why didn't we pay for our bill today?" And he says, "We like Jesus. He's gonna come like a thief in the night." What in the world are you talking about, my guy? Right? That's right. So, if it's not biblical, run, run. Right? Just when you hear people saying things, and it's supposed to be from this word, and it's not, flee them. There's no association with that, okay? I want you to go to Proverbs 2. And we're going to read verses 3 through 5. Proverbs 2, 3 through 5. How many of you, while y'all looking for that, how many of you guys like crab legs? So I'm not kicking against crab legs. I've never really been like a crab person, definitely not a crab leg person. It's like a lot of work.
It is.
It's a lot of work for a little bit of meat. And I just decided I wasn't going to just put all that work in for a little bit of meat. Okay, it might be the technique, but it... Okay. Okay. All right. So listen to what you just guys said. So listen to what we just both discussed. So I said in part that I don't really mess with crabs and crab meat because it's a lot of work to get it out, right? So I just, listen now, I'm just telling you real life experience. So I just cut off crab eating, right? then you guys just share something. Say, oh man, but let me tell you something. You get some Alaskan, it's one crack. You put, I didn't know that. Why didn't I know that? Because I left all of them alone. Last name crab, I don't want nothing to do with you. Right? King crab, little crab, big crab. If your last name crab, I ain't messing with you. But now y'all telling me, you give me new information. Well, it's new to me, but the information has been there all the time. Okay. Guys, it says, yea, if thou criest after knowledge and lifted up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver and searchest for her as hid treasures, then thou shalt understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. So guys, this word is not going to always easily open up to you. You're going to have to search through it. You're going to have to ask God to show, Lord, I'm still not understanding. I need for you to show me this. Why would that be? Let me ask you a question. You got some casual acquaintances. You got some friends. And then you got your ace.
Your ace.
Oh, your ace.
Okay.
Yeah. Your best friend, right? So there are some things that we share with each other casually. Right? There are some things we share amongst friends. But there are some things we only share with our best friends. Right? So the Bible says to be a friend, you show yourself friendly. So sometimes God has things hidden to see how important our friendship is to us. How important, guys, is it to you to find the treasures in this word? Guys, you're not going to go around and find a piece of silver on the ground. Not most likely. Not a treasure of it. How is silver gathered? It's in a mine. You got to dig for it, right? Yeah, I know you guys seen those digging for gold things. Man, they buy all kind of equipment and they sifting through. Hey, we found a nugget. Man, they working to find that gold. But why? Why? Because they know that it can make them rich. If they find enough of it, it can make them rich. Guys, I'm trying to tell you that there are riches in this word. All we have to do is study it and seek it. We'll find it. And when we find it, it'll be life-changing. And that's the part we got to understand. It's not a casual thing. We're not reading it like a verse of the day and say, okay, I read my verse for the day. No, we're looking for this thing to impart into our spirit so that it changes our life. So my point in saying all that in reading this, don't read the word superficially. Like, don't just glance over the word. Like, the word takes time. There's some scripture that you just need to, like, put in the crock pot in your mind. Yeah, just say, okay, Lord, show me what this means. Listen to what other people are saying. Sometimes God will speak to you in themes. Be themes. It'll be waves of the same thing, different people saying different things. So you'll be like, oh man, okay, Lord, I see what you're up to now. You want me to hone in on something. You want me to listen. Okay. And I talked earlier about the Judaizers. The next slide. And I just want to give an example of how we can make an error in this, and we call it text isolation. And I don't know what tunnel vision is, so it might be something Medea would say, but it's supposed to be tunnel vision. So what happens is people take text out of context, right? So let's give an example. Let's go to, and this is law versus grace. So let's first go look at Romans 6 and 14. Romans 6 and 14. It says, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Well, there it is. There it is. I found my sentence in the Bible that agreed with my mindset. I'm not under the law anymore. I'm under grace. Okay. Now let's look at Romans 3 and 31. Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. Yea, we established the law. What? So we have to understand the entire context of what's being said. We can't just take a scripture out of a place and then just say, well, that's it. And then it's got to be in harmony and agreement with what God is trying to share with us. What is going on here? Are we under grace or under the law? What's the problem with the law? The law is perfect. What's the problem with the law? We're not capable of living up to the law. Because you're still living in this flesh. Your flesh can't please God. So Jesus became the sacrifice for us. So we're under grace. It does not diminish the law. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not covet. Those things, are we not under those things anymore? The way that we please God changed. We now accept his son as the sacrifice. Okay? We also have to understand, guys, that there are people who purposely deceive and manipulate the word. We have to be aware of those. Okay? They purposely lead people down a wrong path. Okay? Number six here, again, as I mentioned earlier, we do not speak the original language. So that, remember I was telling you about that letter that my great-grandma wrote? You know, she wrote it in German. So even when we're going from language to language, guys, there are subtleties, right? There are subtleties in the way that things are written and things are said, right? We talked last week about when Jesus used the word love. He used a different type of love than what Peter was using. So we have to take the time to study these things, and if we just carelessly read the scripture, we'll miss out on what God is trying to share with us. All right. Last slide, I won't go too deep into it because of time, but I just wanted to share with you that you hear certain things that are mentioned in the Bible. So I'm going to mention a passage of scripture that we're all very familiar with. It's found in John 4 and 4. And remember when it said Jesus must needs to go to Samaria. Do y'all remember that? Remember the woman at the well? So Jesus was in Jerusalem. So if you looked at the map, Jerusalem is here. Galilee is here. And Samaria is basically in the middle. But what was the deal with Jews and Samaritans? We don't mess with them. That's what they both said. We don't mess with them. So what would happen with the Pharisees would take a longer route to avoid going through Samaria, right? So why did the Bible mention that Jesus must need to go through Samaria? He didn't physically need to go to Samaria. He spiritually needed to go to Samaria, okay? So again, we have to understand the context, what was going on at the time. So what was going on at the time? The Pharisees and certain sects of the Jews did not deal with the Samaritans. So it was unusual for a Jewish leader to want to deal with a Samaritan, okay? Also, there's a term here from Dan to Beersheba. What does that mean? Well, Old Testament correlation. Dan was in the northern kingdom and Beersheba was in the south. So it was a way of saying extremities, right? As far as the east is from the west, north is from the south. That's what is being said. So taking these things in the context, guys, helps us understand what's going on. I'll give you one more before we close. Remember when Jesus came and they started asking, they said, well, when will be, how will we know when the end times come? And Jesus said there would be wars and rumors of wars, right? And y'all said, well, man, that's all the time, right? But at that time, what was going on? Who was in charge then? The Romans. So what was going on in the world then? It was peace. It was Roman peace. The Romans had conquered all these kingdoms, right? And so for Jesus to say that during that time sounded unusual, okay? So anyway, that was kind of my study tonight. You guys got any questions or any thoughts or comments? Not everybody at one time, though. Just.
I think when you said context, that's very, very, very important. We talk about it all the time. There could be dangers in plugging, taking a verse out of scripture and anywhere and use that for all things.
Yeah.
There are some that stand alone. John 3:16. Yes. Stands alone.
It stands alone, but it's also supported by
right.
a reoccurring theme, right? The goal is to recognize that this word is important. You know, Job said it like this. He says, I must have the necessary food of his word more than the physical substance, right? So this word, it needs to nourish your spirit. And you have to understand that there are going to be things and people and situations to come to try to diminish what you think about the word. The word in and of itself is only as powerful as you allow it to be in your life, okay? Some of the things that I discuss here, we need to just take time again. As I said in the beginning, we can never underestimate the power and the influence of the Holy Spirit. That's the advantage that we should have as a believer today that many early Christians didn't have, right? They had the Old Testament. We have the New Testament, the Old Testament. So our tools for discerning and bringing things out in this word are greater now than any time in history, okay? And one of the things I just want to mention before I close is that when we read this word was written to us, not for us. If y'all know what I mean by that. Like it wasn't here to make you feel good about who you were born as. It was this word was to reveal his son. The goodness of the Father towards us. So whatever it says to us, take it. Digest it. Seek to comprehend it. Seek this, how is it going to make you better? How is it, at the end of the day, how is it going to draw you closer to him? How is it going to improve the relationships in your life? Okay? It's from the application of his word. Does anybody have anything else? All right. Let's pray before we go. Dear Lord, we thank you tonight for your word, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the power in your word, Lord. We thank you, Lord God, for just your precious spirit, Lord God. And again, God, we just pray tonight, Lord God, for peace in this house. And I pray, Lord, for just your spirit just reign throughout your people, Lord God. Help us to have a hunger and a thirst for you, Lord God, and not do anything casually, Lord God, but just be intent, Lord God, and have a purpose to know you and just believe, Lord God, that you want to share more things with us, Lord God. Help us to prioritize our life, Lord God, and that we keep you not only at the top of it, but at the center of it, Lord God, that We allow nothing at any time to become more important than you. And God, we just thank you tonight, Lord God. You have heard the names we called out earlier, Lord. But again, praying for healing in the body, Lord God. And again, God, we just thank you, Lord God. There is nothing too hard for you. There's nothing that you're not aware of. And again, God, we lift up all these things to you, Lord. Strengthen our relationships with one another. Help us to draw closer to you, Lord, and know more about you, God. Help us, Lord God, in all these things, Lord. And we give you all the praise. In your son's name, we say thank you. Amen.